Penguin Audio presents Dog Songs and the Thousand Mornings, written and read by Mary Oliver. How it begins. A puppy is a puppy is a puppy. He's probably in a basket with a bunch of other puppies. Then he's a little older and he's nothing but a bundle of longing. He doesn't even understand it. Then someone picks him up and says, "I want this one." How it is with us and how it is with them. We become religious, then we turn from it. Then we are in need and maybe we turn back. We turn to making money, then we turn to the moral life. Then we think about money again. We meet wonderful people but lose them in our busyness. We're, as the saying goes, all over the place. Steadfastness, it seems, is more about dogs than about us. One of the reasons we love them so much. If you are listening to this book, you may not agree, you may not care, but if you are listening to this book, you should know that of all the sights I love in this world, and there are plenty, very near the top of the list is this one, Dogs Without Leashes. Every Dog's Story. I have a bed, my very own. It's just my size. And sometimes I like to sleep alone, with dreams inside my eyes. But sometimes dreams are dark and wild and creepy, and I wake and am afraid, though I don't know why. But I'm no longer sleepy, and too slowly the hours go by. So I climb on the bed where the light of the moon is shining on your face, and I know it will be morning soon. Everybody needs a safe place. The Storm. Bear. Now through the white orchard my little dog romps, breaking the new snow with wild feet. Running here, running there, excited, hardly able to stop, he leaps, he spins, until the white snow is written upon in large, exuberant letters, a long sentence expressing the pleasures of the body in this world. Oh, I could not have said it better myself. Conversations. 1. Said Bear, "I know I'm supposed to keep my eye on you, but it's difficult, the way you lag behind and keep talking to people." "Well, how can you be keeping your eye on me when you're half a mile ahead?" "True," said Bear, "but I'm thinking of you all the time." 2. I had to go away for a few days, so I called the kennel and made an appointment. I guess Bear overheard the conversation. "Love and company," said Bear, "are the adornments that change everything. I know they'll be nice to me, but I'll be sad, sad, sad." And pitifully he wrung his paws. I canceled the trip. Luke's Junkyard Song. I was born in a junkyard, not even on a bundle of rags or the seat of an old wrecked car, but the dust below. But when my eyes opened, I could crawl to the edge and see the moving grass and the trees, and this I began to dream on, though the worms were eating me. And at night, through the twists of metal, I could see a single star, one, not even two. Its light was a thing of wonder, and I learned something precious that would also be good for you. Though the worms kept biting and pinching, I fell in love with this star. I stared at it every night, that light so clear and far. Listen, a junkyard puppy learns quickly how to dream. Listen, whatever you see and love, that's where you are. Luke. I had a dog who loved flowers. Briskly she went through the fields, yet paused for the honeysuckle or the rose, her dark head and her wet nose touching the face of everyone with its petals of silk, with its fragrance rising into the air, where the bees, their bodies heavy with pollen, hovered, and easily she adored every blossom, not in the serious, careful way that we choose this blossom or that blossom, the way we praise or don't praise, the way we love or don't love, but the way we long to be, that happy in the heaven of earth, that wild, that loving. Her grave. She would come back, dripping thick water from the green bog. She would fall at my feet. She would draw the black skin from her gums in a hideous and wonderful smile. And I would rub my hands over her pricked ears and her cunning elbows. And I would hug the barrel of her body, amazed at the unassuming, perfect arch of her neck. It took four of us to carry her into the woods. We did not think of music, but anyway, it began to rain slowly. Her wolfish, invitational half-pounce. Her great and lordly satisfaction at having chased something. My great and lordly satisfaction at her splash of happiness as she barged through the pitch pines, swiping my face with her wild, slightly mossy tongue. Does the hummingbird think he himself invented his crimson throat? He is wiser than that, I think. A dog lives 15 years, if you're lucky. Do the cranes crying out in the high clouds think it is all their own music? A dog comes to you and lives with you in your own house, but you do not therefore own her, as you do not own the rain or the trees or the laws which pertain to them. Does the bear wandering in the autumn up the side of the hill think all by herself she has imagined the refuge and the refreshment of her long slumber? A dog can never tell you what she knows from the smells of the world, but you know, watching her, that you know almost nothing. Does the water snake with his backbone of diamonds think the black tunnel on the bank of the pond is a palace of his own making? She roved ahead of me through the fields, yet would come back, or wait for me, or be somewhere. Now she is buried under the pines. Nor will I argue it or pray for anything but modesty and not to be angry. Through the trees there is the sound of the wind palavering, the smell of the pine needles. What is it but a taste of the infallible energies? How strong was her dark body. How apt is her grave place. How beautiful is her unshakable sleep. Finally, the slick mountains of love break over us. Benjamin, who came from who knows where. What shall I do? When I pick up the broom, he leaves the room. When I fuss with kindling, he runs for the yard. Then he's back, and we hug for a long time. In his low-to-the-ground chest, I can hear his heart slowing down. Then I rub his shoulders and kiss his feet and fondle his long hound ears. Benny, I say, don't worry. I also know the way the old life haunts the new. The dog has run off again. Benjamin. And I should start shouting his name and clapping my hands, but it has been raining all night, and the narrow creek has risen is a tawny.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.